And then you can go here with the mouse, the Internet Explorer, okay, where your great. Things are already yeah. there. You can okay. change here.
If I panic, other. You're next to me, right?
Yeah.
Me too.
Okay. And
you too.
Me too.
Yeah.
So.
Right. Yeah. But I think actually the first one I will start, you know, rather fast with it. Because it's kind of my example that I talk around. So.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah. Okay, okay. So here, and then just with the mouse to.
Yeah, exactly. Escape and then just with the mouse.
Um den Beamer zu bedienen, ne? Also
ja, da tun wir gar nichts, das macht alles Leben. Oder?
Muss ja auch nichts getan werden, ist German.
Ich würde gehen, weil die angefangen haben.
Ah, okay. Das ist schade.
Genau. Oder? Also,
ich brauche noch eine Uhr für irgendjemand.
Ah, ah, ich meine die dann.
Nee, nee.
Ich frage mal die Frau davon.
Genau das Feiern, du warst 15 Jahre. Das Militärregime. Ja. It's good, in case I forget who I am. Where to sit down?
Yeah. Not so hard.
Präsentation heute? Hm? Habt ihr jetzt in dem bei den Keynote PowerPoint Präsentation?
Ja.
PDF.
Habt ihr uns die schon probiert?
Keine Ahnung, frag Ina. Okay, fangen wir einfach an.
Mach ich jetzt das Mikro an.
Das hier? Oder beide?
Ja, beide. Also okay. Normalerweise einfach einbinden.
So, hello. Good morning, everybody. Good morning and welcome again to our fourth day of the conference. My name is Andrea Vetter. I'm of the organizational committee and I have the great pleasure to say welcome to you this morning. Today's theme, as you can see, is visions and strategies for transformation. On the last full day of the conference, we want to go a step further and discuss common projects aimed at a possibly convivial future. And we have two inspiring speakers already sitting here for you who will talk about two very different concepts of visions and strategies. And both are also here to build alliances with other movements. Michelle Bowens, head of the Peer-to-Peer Foundation, will give us insights into the relationship between commons, open knowledge, and degrowth. And Eurydice Manze will then go on with the project of a solidarity economy as part of a degrowth transformation. The speaker's keynote will be in English and in Spanish, so if you need a translation, please got your earplugs. I think you will be already used to that. And note for the canals, the null is for Deutsch.
Channel zero is for the German translation.
And cuatro para español. So it's not the one for German, es ist nicht eins für Deutsch, sondern null.
So the German translation is on channel zero and not as was originally announced on channel one.
This, hopefully. I want to introduce you our first speaker, who is Michelle Bowens, sitting to the left to me. He's originally from Belgium, now living in Chiang Mai in northern Thailand, but he's also at home in very different parts of the whole globe, as he travels a lot, in order to promote the concepts of commons and peer-to-peer production. His last 6 months he spent in Ecuador, where he was invited from the government to develop together with a group of local and global experts a plan for the transition of the country of Ecuador into an open knowledge society. He's the founder of the Foundation for Peer-to-Peer Alternatives and works in collaboration with a global group of researchers in the exploration of peer production, governance, and property. Together with Silke Helfrich and David Boulier, he's a founding member of the Commons Strategies Group. Thank you, Michelle, for being here. I'm looking forward to your talk.
This thing? Oh, yes. Well, thank you for inviting me and to have the chance to speak to a bit of a larger audience. I thought 9 o'clock nobody would be there, but I see there's quite a bit of people who took the effort. Looking at the program and knowing some of my colleagues, what they did here, there's been quite a bit of talk about the commons and how it relates to degrowth. And there's been talk about open hardware in a few workshops. But I want to basically talk a little bit about more the role of the digital commons, more specifically into any transition towards degrowth, commons-based society. So as an example, I took this project, which is called the Newtian Dance Project, to kind of talk a bit around it and show you some of the characteristics of what we call commons-based peer production and why this is an important factor in degrowth strategies. So as you see, if you can see the screen, this is a global community of farmers, citizen scientists, and academic agricultural engineers who have a really crazy idea that if you put good nutrients in the soil, you get better food. In other words, the opposite of toxic industrial agriculture. And as you can imagine, there are no subsidies for this kind of research, or very, very little. So what do you do when you have a very important thing to do and you're not supported by the state or to do this kind of research, and certainly not by Monsanto? Well, what you have to do is mutualize your efforts, right? And this is exactly what they're doing. So imagine that you have an alpine environment in Ecuador,
with steep land, a certain bioclimate zone, and you have labor capital form and escapes the commodity form, right? For example, the core of the value creation in this project is not labor. It's not wage labor that is paid and commanded to do this project. We're talking about the community of contributors. This community of contributors is not producing commodities, they're producing shareable, non-rival, and even anti-rival knowledge goods. So this is not the production of capital. This is the production of commons. Open input, participatory process, which goes together, because if you're, as a community, aggregating without a command structure, you're not gonna obey commands from somebody who is, you know, you don't have a dependency situation with. So the participatory process and the commons-oriented output, because if you want to volunteer and contribute to this project, you don't want it to be privatized. Why would you do it if it's going to be privatized and benefit only one particular company afterwards? So as you see, all these things go together. Now, of course, this is only kind of one side of the question, right? Most of these people, whether they're scientists or farmers, have to make a living. Very likely, the scientists will be paid by some university, public funding, maybe in some cases private funding. The farmers, I would guess, 99% of the case, working for the marketplace, right? But it's also important to know that they don't have to work necessarily fully in the capitalist marketplace, right? They could very well become cooperatives. They could very well become part of the solidarity economy, right? So these commons that we see here at the core of the value creation can be subsumed to a system of capital, like most of open source software is today, and a lot of open hardware is. They have a commons, shared knowledge base, but the economy around it is a capitalist economy. Or you could embed it into a new type of structure. And this is a kind of invitation to think about this as a terrain of struggle, as a terrain of tension, where you do have choices to use what I would call the hyper-productivity of this mode of production for the benefit of a new type of an economy. So let me say a few things about how does this relate to degrowth. Now, I like to... I use this as an object to explain something. So this is a capitalist object, a commodity, right? What can we say about this, apart that it's drinkable? Well, Margaret Kennedy in the 80s, a German monetary theorist, said that, was it 45%? That I think it was, no, 45 or 55% of the cost of this glass of water is debt. Right? So debt-based money creation, you know, which doubles in 20, 30, 40 years, forces people to lend money, to pay back double, and therefore to grow, and all these costs have to be integrated in the price of this glass. The second thing, and I forgot my notebook, so I can't remember the details, it's on my desk in my room, but there was a study about 3-4 months ago that calculated that if you look at the cost of production in materials and energy, amazingly, 3/4 of the cost in our globalized economy is transport. It's not production. It's getting it from here to there. It's getting milk from Germany to Patagonia, where they have the best butter in the world, but it's not competitive, so they buy German milk. Or where I live in Shanghai, it's a very productive agricultural region, but they actually send the food from China, they pass Shanghai, they go to Bangkok, and then they send it back to Shanghai. This is the reality of our globalized capitalist economy. So this is the second aspect that is interesting. And the third, of course, is IP rent, right? All the IP rent, probably not a lot in the case of a glass of water. But generally speaking, it's a huge part of our economy that goes to IP rent to protect the intellectual property protections, right? So this is why, if you move the production to a open form without intellectual property, the first effect will be that, generically speaking, there have been several studies of this, the cost of production goes down to 1/8. So if you change from scientific laboratories using proprietary scientific instruments to a scientific laboratory based on open scientific instruments for the same quality, you can do so for 1/8 of the price. So you can do two things: save money, or you can expand it to 8 times more students and users. The second aspect is, if you combine this open knowledge with distributed manufacturing, with 3D printing, you can start producing locally, and therefore you can produce without the 3/4 of cost that are part of the transport aspect. Thirdly, you could have a system of debt-free money creation, a mutual credit system, or anything that's similar to that, where you eliminate the debt issue, right? So you can see that if you do this intelligently, there is an enormous potential there to create a new type of economy that combines global open design commons with open and distributed local manufacturing of the goods needed by the people at the local level. So it's not pure localization, it's rather, I would say, the very simple rule would be, if it's light, it's global, if it's heavy, it's local, right? So the material production, you move it to microfactories close by, but what you want to do is mutualize the knowledge at the global level and have the farmers in Bhutan work with wherever the knowledge may be, and mutually enrich each other. Now there is one more important, and I think vital argument, which is the following. If you put innovation, science, and research in the private sphere of for-profit companies, how do you design? You design for scarcity, you design for the marketplace, right? So planned obsolescence, it's not a bug, it's a feature. There is probably not a single product today that is not designed to break down, right? Now, compare the potential, for example, of a car. It's one of the 26 open source car projects. When I say car, don't think car, think pickup truck, think tractor, think, you know, they're modular systems, you can do different things with them. Think about the Wikispeed car, which is 5 times as fuel efficient as any car in Detroit. Why is Detroit not producing these cars? They can, they don't want to, right? Because they have legacy systems, they have investments, they have profit motives, and most of the innovation that's done inside these companies, like here in Germany, Volkswagen, are just shelved. They're not being used at all because they don't fit with the growth strategy, the for-profit strategy. What if you are a community? What if you design a product on the basis of need for on-demand production, not supply-driven, not mass-marketing-driven, need-driven local production on-demand in a microfactory? If you design for this kind of environment, you're going to make a sustainable design. You're going to make a modular design. You're going to look at biodegradable materials. You don't have to be a saint or an environmentalist, it just goes with the territory. Now, of course, I'm not saying this is automatic or this is enough. I would say, you know, necessary but not sufficient, right? We can imagine another scenario And this would be a capitalist scenario where in Walmart or Woolworth or whatever, what you use here in Germany, you could buy a $200 3D printer and start making toys with non-degradable plastic, and it would just be another part of the consumption economy, right? So it's not the technology that's kind of magically responsible for this. It's a particular techno-social logic, right? It's a mode of production, it's a mode of relations that is different and that leads to that outcome. And of course, and this is a bit of a contradiction, okay, this is a particular, I would say, eco-friendly group, but most people engaged in peer production are not green, they're not degrowth, they are hackers, you know, free software communities, free culture communities, they're not necessarily politically, ecologically conscious. But again, terrain of struggle. Imagine if you guys here would engage with these communities, would create green fab labs, open sustainable fab labs, would engage, would make those green fab labs in the eco-villages, right? At that point, what you do is you fully synergize, if you like, the potential that's there with green practice, green consciousness, and degrowth aims, right? So these things go together. Now, let's go back to the relation of this to capitalism. Okay, here's the situation. I am a commoner. I am a peer producer. I contribute to a commons. How do I make a living? Well, most of the time, I have to find a job as labor for capital, right? So I produce Linux, open source software, but in order to make a living, I need to work for IBM and the commercial open software economy, which is 70% of the Linux economy. So in other words, what happens is that we have a proto mode of production. It's not a full mode of production, because at this stage, it cannot fully self-reproduce itself, right? Food, shelter, these things are not embedded in the system that you see here. So what can we do about this? Well, here's the thing. As we can see in many countries in Europe, any strategy that's based on labor and the strength of labor and the achievements of labor, universal suffrage, the welfare state, is disappearing because labor is disappearing, right? We are fast moving to a deproletarized economy where one of the three people in the US are already freelancing. They're no more in the labor condition. They are craftsmen, if you like. And it will be one out of two in 2020. In Europe, we have one out of four, and it's moving to one out of three in 2020. And it's these knowledge network knowledge workers that form the social basis of these peer-to-peer and digital commons. Because if you don't work together in physical space, you need to network. You need to find ways of collaboration. You need to share knowledge in a networked environment. So here is something particular that is happening today. And I say it somewhat provocatively, and not everyone is happy when I say this. But here's the thing. So the open source communities use open licenses, like the general public license, Creative Commons, etc. So here's the rule. Here's the rule. The more communistic the license, the more capitalistic the practice, right? It's a contradiction, but this is what happens. Because everybody can share the knowledge, IBM can use Linux. So what we are proposing is something called a commons-based reciprocity license, one of which already exists called the peer production license. And we slightly tweak the rules. What we say is the following. Every common good institution can use our commons. It can be used for every non-profit activity. It can even be used by for-profits if they contribute to the commons. But those for-profits who do not contribute have to pay the license fee. The idea here is not the money, which of course it's always welcome, but the key idea is to reintroduce reciprocity in the marketplace. In other words, to consider this license as a social charter, which requires reciprocity in order to cooperate with your commons. And then, And that's what people, they freak out. You know, they say, oh, but, you know, what's reciprocity? Well, that's exactly the point. You need to organize and discuss to determine what is reciprocity for your particular entrepreneurial coalition that works around that particular commons. And this is the whole point, because in a capitalist society, social and environmental externalities are banned out of the market equation. But we can have like the solidarity economy, where these equations are part of the social charter of the participating maybe members. One of the good news is that we had a talk, and we were going to work together on this license with the solidarity economy coalitions. Next step that we propose is the notion of open cooperativism. So what does that mean? Well, co-ops are nice. They practice economic democracy, but in many cases they're also selfish. They work within the capitalist competition dynamics. And then you have things like Mondragon going to Poland. Don't want the Polish workers to be cooperators because that affects their bonuses. And so they hire them at a minimum wage and they have a strike against Mondragon, the cooperative in Poland. That was 2-3 years ago, right? So here is a tweak. An open cooperative is a cooperative that is common good oriented. So in other words, within its statutes, internal statutes and regulations, it has a common good orientation, not a for-profit orientation. It's multi-stakeholder, so it's not just for the workers. Everybody affected by your activity has a say in the governance. Third, and this is new, because the two first already exist, they're called solidarity cooperatives. And 98% of the new co-ops in Quebec are solidarity co-ops, so we're good. It's, you know, we're moving in that direction. Same in the northern of Italy. But what needs to happen is a third factor, which is co-production of the commons, right? This can be digital commons, so using open licenses, not closed licenses. This can be producing physical commons. The Alianza Solidaria in Quito is reclaiming the ravines of South Quito and making them into public resources because they're dumps right now. They're cleaning them up, putting parks, and sharing that with the communities. This is a civic commons. But we could also imagine machine commons, right? Our production, our productive capital could be conceived as a commons. And there are ways to do that, land, community land trust, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the third requirement. The fourth would be global orientation. This is a bit, again, a field of tension between the localists and the alter globalists. And so the idea is, even though that we can produce locally, I believe we need to organize globally, right? We need to reconstruct economic and social power for this counter economy. So what labor did in the 19th century, and what is being gradually lost because labor is dissolving in front of our eyes, we need to reconstruct social economic power around the commons. And I think we can do this around politics as well. I'm not good at math, but I made a little calculation that if we can unite digital commoners, think about the pirate parties, the platform parties, if we can unite the Greens, if we can unite the new transformative left parties like Podemos and Syriza, for example, and I would argue actually progressive social liberals because they represent the new progressive entrepreneurs, we have a social majority around the commons, potentially coalitions in Europe that are aligned around the commons and can find a counterweight against the rise of the radical right, right? Because as we know, the radical right has socialist policies and our socialist parties have neoliberal policies. So we have a problem here, right? Okay, so it's not a very beautiful slide, but it will do. So maybe this is kind of like class struggle 3.0, if you want to call it that way. So here's the thesis. We are moving, and I know this sounds a bit techno-determinist, but I think this is really the case. We are moving largely towards peer-to-peer systems, network systems in every domain of social life. But there are huge issues of ownership and control. So this helps you have a kind of a vision of what's happening in that sphere. As we move to peer-to-peer systems, to commoning, to commons, to digital commons, even within the capitalist sphere, we get some tension. So the vertical axis is centralized versus distributed, and the horizontal axis is for profit versus for benefit oriented. So here's the weird thing. Can you have centralized for profit peer-to-peer systems? Sounds a bit contradictory, but Facebook massively enables and empowers 2 billion people to engage in permissionless horizontal communication and self-organization. It's just a fact. We may like Facebook or not, but at the front end, that's exactly what they do. But what about the back end? Do you have control on the design of Facebook? Do you have a say in the governance of Facebook? Do you capture the value that's created by the users of Facebook? No, right? So it's a centralized technology owned by for-profit shareholders who determine and nudge and steer your behavior. And they capture 100% of the value that is being created by the users community. So think about community. So think about a system of capitalism where 100% of the value is captured by capital and 0% of the value is shared with those who create the value. Is that sustainable? I don't think so. So some of, you know, cognitive feudalism, if you like, right? This is a return to kind of a feudal scenario. Another solution is, let's distribute the structures, but still with a for-profit orientation. And this is, you know, the program from our good friends in the anarcho-capitalist community with Bitcoin, right? Bitcoin is designed with a deflationary design, so the value goes up, the supply grows slower than the demand by design. And so the whole dynamic of Bitcoin is around profiting from the Bitcoins that you have, right? So we have here a money which is formally peer-to-peer in its production, because every computer, in theory, can produce the Bitcoins. But in fact, because it's more and more expensive to do so, we have a monopoly in mining. The Gini coefficient of Bitcoin is higher than what they call fiat currency. And so Bitcoin is really a very unequal money, but the philosophy, if you like, is peer-to-peer in the sense, that everybody can be a trader, right? That's the philosophy there. But I think it's important to see that Bitcoin, this is the point I want to make, right? When we are in a network, it's not obvious who is the us and the them, because you have a networked graph around you. But if you look at the infrastructures that make it possible, the design, the architecture, that's where the struggle happens. That's what the network field operates. So here's, and of course I put that on the left, which is a bit strange, but you have to imagine this as a time thing, right? So we want to move away from the dominant form, which is controlled by capital, to a form of commons-based peer production that is subsumed under a commons and a commoner paradigm. So here we have two different polarities as well. I would call it local orientation and for benefit orientation versus global orientation and for benefit orientation. So the first thing we have on the bottom right is the extraordinary revival of local resilient initiatives. And don't think they're not related to technology, they are. The ability to create local currencies, to do new supply chains for local food, has been extraordinarily facilitated by network technology. And for example, in the US, again, I left my notes on my table, there was a 48% growth of urban food production, largely peer-to-peer driven, in just 2 years, right? So there is a revolution going on, if you like, bottom-up, grassroots, around reorganizing supply chains, reorganizing local monetary systems through networks, but not always with a global vision. Okay, I may be wrong here, but when I look at the transition town movement, yes, they are globally organized. Yes, they share, but they share to do local, right? I don't see necessarily a vision that also has a global component in terms of strategy. And I think we need it. So this is why I believe we also should move to the bottom, to the top right, in this case, which is a global orientation and a for-benefit orientation combined. So how could this work? Well, imagine, I'll take the Wikispeed as an example. So what do we have? We have a global open design commons that already exists. Engineers from the whole world are designing collectively this car. It's an amazing project. 3 months, 80 people in 12 countries design a car that's 5 times as fuel efficient as an industrial car that can be made in 8 hours in a local micro factory. And they can make trucks and pickups and tractors just by, you know, adapting the design. It's kind of a legal system, right? So that global open design community already exists. Then we have, and that doesn't really exist yet, maybe just on experimental basis in that case, but then we have the micro factories. These are the local people who want to make transport items for their community in their rural fab lab or rural hackerspace using these designs. What is missing, and this is something that another group called Lazinias has called a file or a phile, from the Greek word of clan, and we're all inspired by our Bible in the P2P movement. It's a science fiction book called The Diamond Age from Neil Stephenson. So that's where we get all our inspiration from, is the notion of global business ecosystems that sustain commons and their communities. So the onus, the polarity here is not on the business, it's on the community. And for example, at the P2P Foundation, we have the same problem, right? We pre-produce knowledge about peer production. And we've done largely as volunteers. Well, you can't volunteer all the time, right? You have to eat. So how do we sustain our work? But the thing that's important here is that our economic activities have to support our commons. Otherwise, there is no point to it, right? So this is the new logic. That the file, if you like, is a global ecosystem that supports a particular commons to sustain it, to grow it, and to create livelihoods for the people involved in the creation of the commons. Okay, I have 5 minutes, so let's make a little historical conclusion. So imagine we live at the end of the Roman Empire, and at some point, the cost of expansion is bigger than the benefits of expansion. So the empire stops growing. No more slaves, and you can't breed slaves. It's not economical. No more gold, because they comes from the outside. So what do? There's less and less money to buy the legions. There's less and less money to buy the overseers in the domains of the slave owners. The slaves are fleeing. The Germans, the Germanic tribes, when they're in front of a German city, they tell the slaves they will be free if they win. So all the slaves escape from the cities whenever a Germanic tribe appears. So they're facing all these problems. So what you have here is an exodus of the slaves from the slavery system towards what would eventually become the serf-based system. And you have a reorientation of the slave owners who think, well, maybe I should free my slaves, keep 50% instead of 100%, but then I don't need my soldiers, you know, I don't need so many soldiers to repress the slaves, right? The other thing that happened is, what do you do when you have a resource crisis, which is what happened in Rome? Well, you do two things. You mutualize knowledge. So the monks, right? The monks were the global open design community. They were the engineers of the time, and they share knowledge, and they create European civilization based on the sharing of their knowledge. you mutualize your living arrangements. The monasteries, very light footprint, but everybody had shelter and food and a very rich spiritual life. So look at today, what's happening today. We have a resource crisis. We have an exodus, right? Labor is bleeding out and is becoming freelance, crafts-based, commoning-oriented knowledge work in many cases. But it even service workers and production workers have more and more these aspects in their life. So we have an exodus and we have a reorientation of the smarter parts of capital towards network capital, the Googles, the Amazons, the eBays of our world. And who are the monks today? Well, they are the people, for example, in the Catalan Integral Cooperative. If you go there, you join them, 2,000 people, the first thing they tell you is what you need to live and to realize the project. And from now on, you don't have to worry because we'll make sure you have the basics. And they're degrowth oriented and everything they do is open source, right? So they're an open cooperative producing commons and they're degrowth oriented. So I'm not suggesting everybody should go there, but I think most of us should be thinking of moving partially in some of these directions, because this is going to be an absolutely necessary part of the transition towards degrowth. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Michelle. I think there's a lot of stuff in that to discuss. And some of you will feel now like, oh, I have to talk to this man and say, no, he is not right, or yes, he has right. You can not do this now, as you maybe know already from the other keynotes the days before. But you can do this in a panel that will be after this session, a panel on the experiences of technology worldwide, where Michelle will be part. So now we come to our second speaker. And before, I think I see that you collectively organize yourself in a very good way, thanks to Dad. So just to remind, just go in this row so that people from the outside can easily slip in, because there's constantly flocking from behind, a lot of people coming in. So just come together a little bit. Thank you. I will also remind you that the next talk by Euclides Manse will be given in Spanish. So if you do not speak Spanish or understand Spanish and you do not have any translation device, you should now get it, because otherwise you would not be able to understand what he says. So for the translation, the kernels, they are not rightly indicated here. So it's the Null für Deutsch, it's second.
So it's channel 0 for German, channel 2 for English, and channel 4 for Spanish.
Numbers today. So I start with the introduction of our second speaker. Welcome here, Euclides Manse. Euclides is a Brazilian philosopher and one of the most renowned theorists of solidarity economy and philosophy of liberation. He is one of the founders of the Philosophy of Liberation Institute. He worked in projects of the UNESCO and FAO and helped to establish Solidarius Brazil. Since 2000, he gives popular courses on the organization of solidarity economy networks,
collaborates with solidarity economy organizations worldwide, and last published Solidarius Constellation. Today, he will talk about the economy of liberation, solidarity economy, and good living. And he will do this in Spanish, so in case you do not understand Spanish, please use your translation device. And the channel zero is for German, and second is for English. So welcome, Euclides.
It's blue, but okay. Well,
is it not supposed to be blue?
No, okay, okay, no problem.
Yeah. It's not the red light? That's when you send it to Nina, no?
Yes. Oh. Okay, okay, okay. Thank you.
Muy buenos días a todas. Muy buenos días a todos. Agradezco la invitación por hablar hoy acá.
Thanks very much for having invited me here. I'm delighted to be here at this conference and talk to you. To talk to you about the solidarity economy and good living. It seems like people cannot really hear me yet. I'll try to speak a bit, to speak up a bit. So, my topic. First of all, we need to.
Como se organizan las comunidades humanas? Como funciona la economía capitalista? Para después entonces poder aclarar mejor. Los seres humanos tienen que colaborar entre sí, crean relaciones sociales. Ninguno de nosotros puede proveer todo lo que necesita. En esas relaciones sociales que los seres humanos crean, ellos organizan sistemas de intercambio. En estos intercambios que hacen entre sí, ellos generan los medios que permiten organizarse de manera colaborativa. Cooperando de manera voluntaria o también de manera impositiva, los seres humanos generan los medios simbólicos del intercambio. Posibilitan organizar nuestra cooperación social. Y En estos intercambios de manera voluntaria o impositiva, ellos van creando los medios simbólicos para hacer el intercambio de conocimiento, crean los lenguajes, crean las palabras, organizan sistemas de intercambio para atender sus necesidades materiales y entonces producen bienes y servicios que también intercambian entre sí. Pero para organizar sus relaciones sociales también intercambian poder y organizan funciones sociales que posibilitan entonces organizar la sociedad de una manera que pueda reproducirse. Esas necesidades, relaciones sociales e intercambios condicionan el surgimiento, el desarrollo y la realización práctica de nuestras libertades. Maior liberação ou também relações de opressão. E estas relações de liberação e de opressão que se fazem com fluxos de conhecimento, com fluxos de poder, com fluxos de bens e serviços, conformam uma formação social. Esta formação social organiza estas relações de los miembros de la comunidade e va a modelar estos fluxos de conhecimento, estos fluxos de poder, estos flujos de materias, sí. Y la transformación de su modo de vivir, intercambiando productos simbólicos y materiales, los seres humanos van perfeccionando los productos simbólicos y materiales. Los seres humanos van perfeccionando el lenguaje, la conciencia de sí, de la naturaleza, de la sociedad, el modo de producir, de intercambiar, y la formación social que los integra. Realizan el continuo desarrollo de las fuerzas productivas. Este es un punto muy importante que vamos a volver después. Que posibilitan generar medios de uso para atender nuestras necesidades y deseos. Y con esto expandir la realización de nuestras libertades. Por esto, la transformación de las comunidades humanas, cuando las analizamos, necesitamos comprender estas tres dimensiones. ¿Sí? ¿Qué son? La subformación social, los sistemas de intercambio que tiene y los modos de producir aquello que estas sociedades necesitan. Bueno, ¿cómo funciona la economía capitalista en estas tres dimensiones? Su modo de producción es organizado para la acumulación de ganancias, para la acumulación de lucro. Por tanto, explota el trabajo ajeno que es subordinado, ¿sí? De esta manera, de producir el producto, después lo lleva al mercado para convertir el producto en una mercancía para hacer qué cosa, para acumular dinero. Entonces tenemos un sistema de intercambio, que es el mercado, que posibilita que el valor de cambio de la mercancía se pueda convertir en capital. Este producto, por tanto, convertido en mercancía, va a ser intercambiado por signos, por símbolos, por sinales de valor, ¿sí? En forma de dinero. Y es justamente esta pasaje de la particularidad del valor que está en la mercancía para la universalidad en el ámbito de los signos que permite que el capital se pueda universalizar. O sea, el capital se convierte en dinero. Por esto el mercado, ¿qué es? Para el capitalista, es un proceso en que el dinero se convierte en medios productivos para convertirse en un producto.
And this creates a kind of circle. Labor is being made a commodity which again is being made part of the production process, which becomes a good, and then capital, and then goods again. The economic value under the reign of the money is something that is decoupled from the goods. And in order to do that, you need to agree on certain things so that you can all agree on money as the exchange value. For that, we need rules. We need laws by the state so that the exchange of money and goods is regulated. So money is subject to those laws and to the regulations.
The social order, the capitalist social order, disposes of the state as a medium. And one of the things, there are several things that are essential to maintaining the system of accumulation. The first thing is money. Money needs to be subordinated to the rules of circulation, but also to those of accumulation. It's a matter of how capital is maintained and traded and how economic value is preserved. Then there's the issue of private property. Here we're speaking about the means of production, but also about the private ownership of money. The circulation of money following the rules set by the state and the rules that have been agreed upon, we're talking about law here, i.e. the notion that debt has to be paid, very concrete ideas. There are certain crises when a value is lost and when these agreements are not honored. So there's a whole system of rules, and at the same time, the labor of others is exploited, the alienated labor, one could say. So how is labor exploited? How is this done? In what ways is this done? What is the intensity of the exploitation of labor? Here too, there's a whole system of rules that regulate this. And then recourse is taken to political power, and the hegemonic political power is in a position to subordinate the forces and to limit the forces, to oppress the forces of those who wish to liberate themselves from the exploitation of their labor, and who also want to free themselves from enclosed knowledge flows and all the other rules that have been set up. How is the subordination of the forces of production organized? The development of the forces of production means that the freedom can be extended. And if one does it in an intelligent way, one can reduce the employment of labor. But in the capitalist system, we can see that everything is oriented toward the accumulation of capital. The development of the forces of production creates the possibility of creating economic forces that can produce more with less labor. But in order to maintain accumulation, there needs to be the maintenance of a certain degree of scarcity. There needs to be a certain link between supply and demand. But if the supply is to be large, the products need to be of such a quality that they don't last for a long time. So the light bulbs are only usable for a certain period of time. They could be created, they could be produced in such a way that they last longer, but that, of course, runs contrary to the interests of the corporation. The corporation has an interest in selling as much as possible. Competition between companies leads to a drop in prices, and these falling prices means that profit margins decrease, but at the same time, markets are expanded, and so total revenue is increased. People don't have enough money to pay for their consumption, and so a credit system is introduced, and this leads to the development of forms of credit that are geared to allowing people to pay their to go about consuming. And so there's consumer credit, and then you have the problem of inflation, and all of this is part of the larger problematic of the accumulation of values and the larger problematic of capital. Now, the debt that develops has another consequence. It has an effect on the amount of money that is available and on market conditions. Why do the workers subordinate themselves to this regime of exploitation? Well, because they need to satisfy certain needs, and these needs that need to be satisfied have to be paid for by means of money. So if they don't have any money to buy things on the market, they cannot satisfy their needs. We have a billion people in the world who are suffering from hunger. They don't have enough money to buy food. But in 2008, we had a capitalist crisis of overproduction. But overproduction in relation to what? Well, in relationship to the demand on the market, but not in relation to the actual needs of people. So people are forced, because of their needs not being satisfied, to remain a part of this process in which labor is subordinated, in which it becomes so-called human capital, in which it is exploited, and where other people decide how they are to lead their lives and spend their time. So these are some aspects concerning capitalism and its effects on our societies. But now I want to address the topic of the economy of liberation. The situation we have today is such that we can say that there are millions of people who are struggling to create dignified ecological societies. There are many, many networks that include a variety of actors. Take the World Social Forum, for example. It's just one small example of the many efforts that we have worldwide. Millions of actors. These millions of actors are mobilizing billions of dollars across the world in their networks. So these actors are mobilizing this money. But what we then see is that these actors, or at least some of them, take to the streets and they say, we've had enough. They occupy squares. They say, we want a different kind of economy. Even though there are authoritarian governments, and even though in some countries democratic governments are being instituted, well, what happens to the economic circuits of these actors? Well, they continue reproducing capitalism, and because they continue reproducing capitalism in order to satisfy their needs, they are constrained to purchase products. And what does this lead to? Well, they have to accumulate money. The corporations accumulate money. And what are they going to do with this money? Well, they're going to keep producing products that destroy the planet. So we're talking about products that were designed to maintain scarcity. All of this constantly reproduces the capitalist system. All of these factors contribute to the reproduction of the capitalist system. So what do we need to do? Well, in order to resist this development, we need the organization of cooperative networks that include various flows and we need to harness these flows with an eye to bringing to extending our power and our influence. But we also need to combine our economic circuits and have an exchange of our knowledges so that we can build a different society and a different mode of production, and so that we can bring about a good life for everyone. So how can this be achieved? Well, by building cooperative networks that satisfy three criteria. They have to be networks of of power and of material exchange. At the same time, they need to reinforce one another. What does that mean? We have to build horizontal networks so that cooperation between people isn't the kind of cooperation that is subordinated to the capitalist system. If it's a kind of cooperation that is based on solidarity and on cooperation between people, so that the freedom of the generality of society as a whole, but also of private persons, is extended, then you secure a good life for everyone. At the same time, we need to make sure that use values are produced in such a way that they promote the good life, and that they allow people to live in a self-determined way within public life. At the same time, it needs to be ensured that every person can lead a life in dignity, can make decisions for themselves. We need the liberty of the private and the public person, and they need to reinforce one another within an ethics of solidarity. And this leads us to the theme of the economics of liberation. How does one organize the economics of liberation? The goal of this economy is to liberate people, to liberate them from subordinated labor, from exploited labor, from a situation in which their needs are not satisfied, in which there is a power that oppresses people. We want the forces of production to develop freely in a way that has been liberated from the logic of capital, and we want all of these forces of production to be put at the service of the organization of a good life. This doesn't mean taking steps backward when it comes to technology, for example. It means using technology to extend our liberty, both within public and within private life. In doing this, we're basing our action on the practice of liberation that is engaged in by the economic actors who are struggling to liberate themselves. And this is where a principle from liberation pedagogy, as it was developed by Paulo Freire, comes in. He said that no one liberates himself all by themselves. People liberate each other. And that's something that we already noted when we took a look at how human communities are structured. In order to liberate people, it's necessary to create a new social structure, a new structure within the mode of production. Often, it's only the mode of production that is taken into consideration. But if there are other areas that continue to be subordinated to the market and exposed to the scarcity created by the market, then this leads to an absence of structural transformation. So, if demand... No, we need to create a situation in which the needs of people are satisfied, in which there is an exchange of use values that are not created in accordance with the logic of capital and the logic of scarcity. That's how we go about securing the good life. These new social structures, this new social order, has various aspects. Cooperation between people based on democracies and solidarity, so that everyone's freedom can be extended. The reorganization of the exchange of knowledge, but also of economic circuits and of the power structure. This leads to the emergence of a public power, which is not, however, subordinated to the state. A public power that is something other than the state. In order to confront the networks of the state, we need a different kind of actor. And we can achieve this by restructuring the circuits that exist in the way that I've described, so that the forces of reciprocity can become active, so that we have horizontality and self-administration. And what results from this is a new social order that is based on these cooperative networks. In order to achieve this, it's necessary to reorganize the exchange of knowledge. Without knowledge, there can be no liberation. This exchange of knowledge, of information, of education needs to be organized on a horizontal level. The means available for doing this and for allowing communication have to be the property or have to be owned and controlled by the communities and the people themselves. Power to control knowledge and the transmission of knowledge is too concentrated. There's too much of a monopoly of this at present. We need to and in order to change the situation, we need language. We need language that makes it possible to communicate and to understand one another. It's impossible to represent reality if we don't have the language that is required for this. Language is the product of a community. A single person cannot create language. So it's necessary for us to recognize the value of language and communication. I cannot communicate on my own. I cannot think on my own. I need knowledge to liberate myself. I need other people's knowledge to liberate myself. I cannot liberate myself. People can only liberate themselves within common processes, common forms of participation by which they realize or learn how our reality is constituted and develop a critical understanding of how their relations are organized. Liberation always means a form of implementation and a progressive forward motion. There is no sudden rupture. It's just like when a new dance is created or a new kind of food is created. The process of liberation works in exactly the same way. And there will never be a definite ultimate liberation. It's always an ongoing process. And in order to achieve this, it's necessary to organize the structures of power in a different way. Public spaces need to be reconfigured, taken away from the state. They need to become self-administered spaces. Our communities need to be able to decide autonomously what is important to them, and these decisions need to be taken in a democratic and collective way. The flows of material goods, the power structures, and the exchange of knowledge need to, as it were, fertilize one another in order to reinforce the community. And in this way, we can create new forms of the self-organization of the power structures. This strong public force is then capable to exert pressure on the state and to change the state so that the state democratizes itself, so that it creates new structures for decision making, so that the community can actually participate in decisions, and so that the oppressed can be helped in their efforts to liberate themselves, so that they can realize their ethical freedom and shape the way they lead their lives. In order to create these new spaces of production and exchange that are not subordinated to the state, what we have is a deep privatization of the state, because if we reinforce these structures, these circuits of solidary economy, what we experience at the same time is a weakening of the capitalist circuits. And so we succeed in actually withdrawing from capitalism its power. We succeed in deprivatizing state policy by creating a new society that is economically just and solidary. As far as the circulation of material goods is concerned, I've already said something about this earlier. These circuits need, of course, to be structured in an ecological manner, and they need to be organized in such a way that human needs are satisfied. Is it a question of satisfying a final consumption, or is it a question of satisfying the needs of production? Well, these circuits need to be organized by the communities themselves in the interest of the communities, and these means need to be employed in a way that is ecologically sound. We have to recognize the differences between different kinds of resources. There are renewable and there are non-renewable resources. Resources need to be recycled. Resources that cannot even be recycled, we shouldn't be using them at all. So we have to take note of a whole series of issues in order to arrive at a rational usage of resources. This also concerns the emission of pollutants, which needs to be reduced as far as possible. Unfortunately, I don't have enough time to address all of these problems. How does this reorganization of society occur in a solidary way? How do we reorganize the circuits? How do we develop new forms of exchange, new systems of exchange that are necessary to our liberation? These new modes of production could be organized in the following way. Collective cooperation, self-administration, the self-administration of the means of production. The use of the means of production doesn't have to be subordinated or oriented to the maximizing profits. It can also be oriented to the construction of a democratic society and to the liberation of the means of production from the logic of capital. This means that we don't have to simply adopt all of the technological means that have emerged from the capitalist market. There are technologies that are not suited to a new social order and that we should stop using for this reason, so that products can be produced in a way that is ecologically sound and solidary, so that we achieve a really genuinely ecological economy. That's also part of solidary economy. There are new possibilities of exchanging economic means. And this exchange always needs to serve the good life. Many of the products that come from the capitalist system are products that we don't really need, but unfortunately we're constrained to continue using them until we can ourselves produce all of the products required for satisfying human needs. To do this, we don't necessarily need capitalist money. The communities can develop symbolic values of their own. We need to oppose something to the scarcity of money and create a system that ensures that we can really satisfy the needs of people. To do this, we need means that contain value, and this value needs to be determined by the stakeholders, by the communities themselves. What does the community have to offer? Well, it offers work, it offers services, and it exchanges those with or against a new exchange symbol that is not capitalist money. In order to implement this vision and to circulate these tokens of value, as I would call them, on an international level, we need international networks. These means of value have to be usable throughout the entire solidary economy. We have internal transactions that can be affected without capitalist money, but when there is contact with the capitalist system, we do, of course, need to make use of capitalist money. We need to create common funds containing money that solidary communities can make use of in order to produce means of production that are currently only being produced in the capitalist world. I've spoken for 32 minutes so far, so I have 13 minutes left to conclude my speech. Well, why do we want to be free in the first place? Well, it's a question that is mainly raised by philosophers, but it's a very fundamental question. If we want to liberate ourselves, then this is due that we feel such freedom and liberation is necessary. In 1989, we formulated the following question. We want to be free in order to lead a good life and secure a good life, a bon vivir, as we say in Portuguese. The good life, bon vivir, is the basic idea behind liberation. That's the value that we orient ourselves to. It's our reference value. This relationship between the good life and the reorganization of the economic system became very widespread in Latin America in the 1990s. There were various currents of thought, and they all contributed to the development of the concept. It's mainly a question of building networks, productive networks that serve everyone's well-being. This is a matter of exchanging means of production, exchanging knowledge, and reorganizing the flows of means of production. In Ecuador, a concept was developed, a concept of solidary economy, and it was developed together with the indigenous communities who were able to bring into the concept the experience of their forefathers. And the concept was written into the constitution of Ecuador. Solidary economy was recognized as one sector of the economic activities within Ecuador. Another subject, the concept of solidary economy was also a subject discussed at the social forum. The good life is a category that examines both oppression, that looks at how public freedom can be created, and that has taken note of the fact that the liberation of the means of production and of the means of knowledge is necessary in order to generate this kind of public freedom. And this distinguishes this concept from other concepts that have been presented here. So what are the conditions? Well, for one thing, there are the streams of material goods. We need to create a balance within the ecosystems, because if we don't do this, then life will not be possible. And then, of course, there will not be any good life either. If the plants die, then we will die as well, because we won't have any air to breathe. So in order to maintain life, we need to secure the balance of nature. We also need to make sure that we have available economic means which make it possible to create work and new products in the first place. Every person has the right to decide themselves how they want to lead their life, to what extent they want to influence the state, civil society, and the community. The exchange of knowledge, access to information, to different perspectives on life, on the world, intercultural dialogue, the development of new ways of thought, these are all necessary conditions for our liberation. A liberating education in which no one learns on their own, but where everyone learns together, also entails a necessary process of transformation, of the transformation of our present. The ethical component of the concept of good life is important when it comes to this. Perhaps I should be speaking a little more slowly. Well, liberation from an ethical perspective consists or exists when it is when it serves the liberation of others. So if I promote my own freedom in an ethically appropriate way, then this also allows other people to extend their own freedom. Of course, I need certain means to do this. I need shelter, I need culture, I need education, I need food. All of these means need to be available to everybody. That's the micropolitics of everyday life that makes possible the self-creation of every single person in the first place, that makes it possible for everyone to organize themselves in the way they want to, what kind of sport they want to do, where they want to live. These things need to be decided by people themselves. All this has to be possible, and at the same time, it's necessary for people to have access to information and education to make a life and dignity possible in the first place. This is the kind of freedom that makes possible the freedom of others. If I liberate myself only to exploit others, that's not an acceptable concept of freedom. If I create freedom to destroy ecosystems, that's not the kind of freedom that does justice or that accords with my own ethical ideas, because it isn't compatible with the freedom of others. So this brings me to my final point. I have another 6 minutes left. Well, in a democracy, you need to respect the amount of time that is allocated to you. So how can we build these networks of solidary economy? In Latin America, we have developed various different systems and concepts, and I'll be presenting one of them here. To begin with, we need to take stock of the needs that actually exist. What are the needs of the communities? What are the needs of economic projects? What are the needs of the political organization? But we also need to take note of how production is organized. Another step is that of the analysis of the flows of exchange. We do this in order to find out what it is we really need and what we need to produce so that we can satisfy existing needs. How can we reorganize valorization chains? We need consumption plans, need plans. We need to ascertain what people really need. What do the governments need? And when we have drawn up these plans, we can use them to develop production plans. To do this, we need markets in the plural, not one market, not the capitalist market. We need marketplaces, spaces and squares where this exchange can take place. What can be produced at the local level should be produced at the local level. What can't be produced at the local level has to be produced somewhere else. And in this way, we can build networks of solidary economy where technological exchange, an exchange of knowledge, and the exchange of services and goods takes place. What is it that we can exchange within these networks, and what is it that the networks cannot produce themselves and needs therefore to be purchased from outside? Well, for as far as everything that comes from outside is concerned, we need money, of course. But what we exchange within the network, we don't need money to go about that exchange, because we can create alternative symbols of value. So what this shows is what we can see here is a unit of value that a network in Honduras created as a means of exchange, and using it within the network as a way of exchanging goods and services. I have another example from Mexico. When someone from within this network purchases a good or a product, it uses these means of exchange, but money is no longer required. Here we can see an example of cooperative banks. There are thousands of them in Brazil. So these new value systems are created in order to allow for the exchange of means of production within networks. But this is not money. These are value means that have emerged within self-administered communities. Such value means are already being used in thousands of cases within such communities. There are about 3.5 million people who have already used such value means in the past. So they allow people to determine value themselves and to determine what the value of these newly created value tokens is to be. To do this, one could conceivably even use electronic systems. But what's most important is that is a self-administered character of these processes. People need to decide themselves what value they want to attribute to these value means. And this also requires the creation of a fund for common economic activity, a fund that provides monetary means to allow for the purchasing of products from outside the network, from the capitalist system. How can we create these credit systems on the local and on the international level? Well, in 2007, we engaged in an experiment on the international level. We noted, or we were able to discover, that self-organization and cooperation between more than 20 countries is possible and can work. And we tried to find out how this can be organized at the global level. Our consumption, the consumption needs of the families, our self-organization, if all of this is organized in a solidary way, then we can succeed within the networks of offering certain products and services ourselves. At the same time, we can also create a system where people can have recourse to these funds in order to purchase goods and services from outside the network, from the capitalist system. So we need a development of the forces of production in order to make solidary economics possible. And this has to be a progressive forward motion. This new mode of production needs to go hand in hand with a new form of circulation based on the collective exchange between people and communities. To do this, we need to invent a new economic system that is really serving the satisfaction of human needs and which is expanding operating on an ever greater scale. It's never a matter of maximizing profits. This is only about satisfying the needs of human beings. But what happens with capital accumulation when all of this happens? What does capitalist accumulation do when it notices that these networks are operating increasingly independently of capital? Well, the capitalist market notices that it's, as it were, lost the subjects it needs because the people are no longer dependent on the capitalist process. And this allows for the creation of new networks and new forms of exchange. Unfortunately, I've actually spoken for 1 minute and 59 seconds longer than I was allowed to. Thank you.
Gracias.
Thank you very much, Euclides, for these far-reaching thoughts. As before, there is no questions here at the keynote. Others at the panel that is following in this room at 11. And I have three more interests.